The science of self-defense as an art martial within Western Europe during the Renaissance period had long meant the discipline of arms, skill in every weapon from dagger to halberd, but especially various kinds of swords. The pragmatic elements of self-defense in this period were ideally learned systematically, following a proven method prescribed by an expert teacher. Skills were acquired and honed in private lesson or small group classes. Reflexes, coordination, and awareness were sharpened through vigorous practice that instilled a natural sense of the spatial geometry and leverage required in personal armed combat. Men-at-arms trained by strengthening exercises, by executing techniques at a post, through mirror fighting or flourishing against a shadow, by drilling in counter-strikes with a partner and through free play or sparring using special blunt or wooden weapons. Physical conditioning was paramount as a long-standing tradition of exercise. Gymnastics and athleticism was not just part of the military profession, but for many became an important aspect of the noble gentleman's way of life. Knightly combatants also engaged in sporting tournament challenges and deeds of arms, while common fighting guilds conducted public displays of mock combat bouting to test their students or challenge rival schools to exhibition contest. All the while, a proper martial spirit was tempered and informed from life experience in real combat. But masters of the art of defense recognized the practical differences between earnest fighting and school fighting, and the need to perform controlled actions during practice for safety, but also with sufficient intensity to properly prepare a fighter for when the actual thing came. They understood that in learning a martial art, what hurts teaches, and that a manner of true fighting is only that which works in both rough play and real combat. They further understood that pretenses of courtesy and false etiquette had no place in sudden matters of violent life and death. The masters also wrote, and historical accounts of personal close combat confirm, that wrestling skill was the heart of all fencing in the Middle Ages and Renaissance. The ability to move in close and grapple, to come to grips, to seize and disarm, or throw, or prevent these things, was vital for the fighting man. Renaissance unarmed fighting methods were no less developed and no less sophisticated than their contemporary Asian counterparts. Fighting with or unarmed against the common dagger was also a necessity. The favored type of knife was a long, rigid thrusting blade capable of piercing thick, quilted cloth or finding weak points in most any armor. This extensive knife fighting material by the Renaissance masters has long remained lost and hidden from modern students of the subject. It is almost a cliché to say that personal combat at this time was a sophisticated and highly effective art that employed superb and finely crafted weapons and armor, but it is true nonetheless. To be sure, not every man who took up arms was a skillful fighter or expertly trained in a systematic method. Some men always relied solely on natural talent and nature's gifts to serve them in combat. But to overcome an adversary's physical advantage in size, strength, ferocity, or speed was the whole reason in the first place for an art of defense.